last system in this demo is going to be our liquid Dazzle. This is a metallic epoxy system that is a little bit different than how some of the other metallics are in the market. Now, we've had this system for quite a long time. It's been kind of a very well-noted and well-touted system. And the reason is that we do things a little bit differently in that we have an EC38 product, our liquid Dazzle, that features pigment and metallic already in one. There's no mixing, no complications of adding powders, adding pigments, adding your A and B. It's simply a one kit, A and B, everything's in it, and you simply just add it together. It makes it very, very simple. For example, this is an example of our EC38 in graphite. You can kind of see it's really hard to read these samples because of the reflective qualities of the metallics. But what's really nice about this is, again, you just add part A and B over your properly prepared and primed surface, and you have a really simplified but very, very elegant and nice metallic flooring look. So this is a really, really nice way to go for if you're looking for high-end residential homes, you're looking for any facility, really, that wants to have this kind of bridge of decorative concrete attributes, say something like you might achieve in more of a stained floor, but you get all the functionality and benefits of 100% solids epoxy floor. So you get the chemical resistance, you get the build, you get all of those elements of a seamless monolithic floor, but you get the higher end aesthetic and decorative properties of the metallic epoxy. Okay, so hopefully that helps as just a visual. So the first thing that we're gonna start with is substrate. We already mentioned substrate preparation throughout. It's going to be consistent here. Now we're applying our material a little bit thicker, so we are getting into the CSP3 level on this system. So we're not going to show you the EC12 or EC15 primer because we've already shown that and you kind of are familiar with that. But what we would do is we would have a surface that was properly prepared and primed. We would prime with our EC12. Now, in the metallic epoxy, specifically the liquid Dazzle, you do want to be kind of conscientious of what primer you choose. So for example, we're going to be showing you the EC38 in graphite. So we've gone ahead and primed in a complementary color. Now, if you did have a slab that, say, was really unlevel or a lot of slope, you might need to consider potentially preparing that slab and pouring a self-leveling topping on that. So for example, you could utilize our TC26 or TC27 material to help plane out that floor, even out the substrate to ensure that you're gonna get a nice flat floor and a flat surface to put your metallic epoxy on, okay? If you have a lot of contours, unlevelness, what happens is the metallics or the higher build self-leveling epoxies will run away from it and you might not get the desired effect, or you might lose some of the hide and opacity of your metallic material. So again, considering a self-leveling material like our TC26 or TC27 where appropriate can definitely help, okay? So the first step is, again, priming with the EC12, as I mentioned, using that complementary primer. You are gonna find a reference on our specification sheet and our color charts to indicate the appropriate matching primer of EC12 with the appropriate EC38 liquid Dazzle color. Okay, so we've done that. Now what we're gonna see is Mike Pittman is gonna go ahead and mix up the EC38. Again, simple product, just a part A, part B, available in 1.5 gallon and 15 gallon units. We also have drums available this material. So Mike's gonna go ahead and mix that material up over here and you can see that material going down. Mike, let's make sure we've got our PPE, perfect. We always got to look out for our friends because all of these materials are corrosive and we definitely want to ensure that we have proper PPE, gloves, safety glasses on. Beautiful. So Mike's going ahead and properly applying part B first. Now, we didn't mention this so much earlier, but anytime you're taking multiple batches, multiple products, you always want to consider what's called boxing your part A's, okay? So this is really a helpful tool if you have multiple batches or if you're just doing a large project. Batching would typically mean you take all of your part A's and you combine them together to ensure that there's no inconsistencies. Now, this is true with metallic epoxies. This would also be true with our 100% solids epoxies, for example, say the EC34, okay? So Mike's now getting all of the contents out of the EC38 part A can. In some cases, we've already, before this demo, pre-mixed our part A's, but that's always a great recommendation is to pre-mix your part A's where you may have your color in, or maybe if you're in the EC11 product in your part B. But anywhere where you have your pigment, you want to pre-mix that material to ensure it's consistent. So you can see he's mixing this. You know, additionally, he's going to mix this for 3 to 5 minutes, ensuring a nice homogeneous mix with a low RPM drill, just like we talked about before. But you always want to check shelf life, batches, make sure everything is still in shelf life. You're not applying old or expired material, because no one knows what's going to happen to that product. If it's going to dry properly, if it's going to reach all the chemical resistant properties, all the physical attributes. So always be sure to check the batch number and shelf life of your products, especially if they've been sitting around the shop or the warehouse for some time. So Mike's mixing that. And as he's mixing that, I want to show you some resources available for the system. So with the EC38, we have a color chart here, and you can see that there is these standard colors available. So these standard colors are available. Again, we have liquid samples and cured samples all available to this, but we have a nice kind of broad palette available of all these colors, okay? So you can see there. Additionally, we also have a process sample, and this is what you kind of can see here. This indicates your concrete layer, your primer layer, your dazzle coat or your metallic epoxy coat, and then an optional polyurethane top coat, which we'll talk about in a second and actually demonstrate. In addition to those resources, we also have cured samples available of all of our colors as mentioned. So these are really nice to show the finish. Now, with any kind of decorative epoxy or decorative concrete coating for that matter, a mock-up is really crucial. Now, metallics, just like I would say stains and sealers, you can't 100% guarantee the full finish. And that's kind of sometimes the good and bad part. The good part is that every floor is gonna be slightly different. Every floor will have their own unique flavor, their own unique attributes, their own unique flow. The hard part is sometimes trying to recreate something. We all know the challenges as an applicator of a customer coming to you with a picture on Pinterest. And they say, I want this floor. And you're like, I don't know what that person did. That is a real challenge that we're all faced. So the best way to do that is to reach out to us directly. If you're not sure of what the material was, if you're not sure how they got to a certain effect, for example, with metallic epoxies, there's a lot of people doing a lot of various manipulations to create different looks. We have a similar treatment called our Dazzle effect, where you basically utilize multiple colors of EC38 together to create a dynamic effect. Or you can use, for example, our dye stain or SC36 to create highlights and a molted effect on there, or a hammered look. But if you have any questions on how to reach a certain color, how to reach a certain effect, you know, maybe you saw something on our website in our galleries and you're like, what color is that? Or how was that achieved? Reach out to us directly and we'll do our best to support you and give you some outlines on techniques or what materials were used for that project. So Mike has gone ahead and properly mixed this material. And so he's going to come over to this board. Now we've gone ahead and primed this board with EC12, again, in a complementary color. We've actually used EC12 pewter gray. Mike's going to go ahead and apply the EC38 and graphite. Now this is a really, really beautiful color. It's very, very rich. One thing you'll notice is he's not just using a squeegee, like a flat blade squeegee. He's utilizing a notch trowel. A notch trowel or notch squeegee is the appropriate tool to gauge this material out. The yield for this material is approximately 50 square feet per gallon. So that's why the appropriate notch trowel or notch squeegee is going to help provide you with the appropriate mills and yield to ensure full coverage. By utilizing this proper mill thickness and application coverage, we're gonna get a beautiful hide, beautiful flow, and an overall really, really unique metallic effect floor. Now again, there's no additional powders, no other materials that are needed. You simply add part A and part B together, and you've got this intricately colored and metallic additive already built into it. Now, there's a lot of varieties on application methods in our industry. We've kind of illustrated on our website through our YouTube page or through our website a lot of different methods that you can do to manipulate the liquid Dazzle. But what Mike's going to show you is a standard methodology. So, Mike, if you can, here, let me see if we can pull this up to the frame. Not everyone has seen this tool, but let's go ahead and see if we can get this. This is called a loop roller. Okay. And you can kind of see these. Let's see if we get it. Maybe it's hard to read that, but you can kind of see it has these little loops. Okay. Those are going to be the appropriate tools to help aerate, pop air bubbles, even out mill thickness, and back roll this material. Okay. I'm going to give that back to Mike. You do not want to use just a standard nap roller. It's going to load up and push the material because we're at that 50 square feet per gallon yield. So as you can see, Mike's just doing a nice light back roll. He's not overworking the material to introduce air bubbles. And he's simply back rolling this to help even out the product, both with regards to mill thickness and effects. Now he could re-roll this a few times. Sometimes you can roll this late. Sometimes you can roll this early. Again, we're kind of telling you the standard way to apply our liquid Dazzle system, but there's really unlimited methods for creating various effects, looks, overall. But this is the best way if you're looking for more of a solid, uniform finish across a large scale project to apply with a notch trowel or notch squeegee, back roll with a loop roller, again, using your spike shoes to ensure that you're into the wet material properly and not, you know, tracking it everywhere with, you know, just regular shoes. And at that point, you would just leave it. This material would move. One thing that we have included into this product is called the drift dynamic, which is an additive that helps create a little flow and movement and will help create a very nice dynamic effect. So you'll see some of the beautiful micas and metallic additives in here to flow and create a very, very nice, beautiful effect across the floor. Again, making no two floors really the same. So that is how you would apply the EC38, again, after a properly prepared EC12 material. We get a question about kind of generally the notch size. Most of the time, you're typically looking at about an 1/8 inch by 1/8 inch notch. But again, you can also correlate that to the Midwest Rateco's mill gauge at the 50 square feet per gallon coverage rates appropriately. So of course, utilizing the right tool, again, if you're always kind of not 100% sure, one thing you can do is pre-walk your site. So if this space right here was, for example, 200 square feet and I've got a 50 square feet yield, I could actually walk out onto the walls. I could come over here and I could put some tape marks on the wall, okay? Now that's not a perfect science, but what that does, it helps give me a visual aid. So as I'm applying this material and I'm notching it out, I need to know that, okay, I gotta get to about this mark with that first batch or that second batch or that third batch or whatever it may be. So I'm ensuring that I'm not stretching the material too thin or more importantly, too heavy, because we don't necessarily need it to be that heavy. And you just need enough mill thickness there to get you nice, even flow, nice build. Okay. So that's the main system. At this point, you can leave the EC38 alone and you do not need to apply any other material on top. Some applicators and facilities will choose to just wax and put a regimen of a waxing program in place. If you have questions on appropriate waxes, please contact us directly. We can talk to you more about what waxes are appropriate versus other waxes. It's not just a standard wax that you typically could buy at, you know, your Home Depot. These are usually urethane floor finishes that are specifically engineered and designed for this type of material. That can be a great way to go. Or what we recommend as an optional choice is to utilize a polyurethane top coat. So we have a variety of polyurethanes from water-based to solvent-based. Our solvent-based line is our EC95 material. The EC95 is a pigmented and clear. In this case, of course, we're going to be using a clear, but we also have a gloss and a satin version, EC95G and EC95F, indicating the different sheens or gloss levels. That would provide you with a solvent-based urethane finish. Now, someone may ask, well, why would I use a urethane, Todd? Why would I elect to put a urethane on top of the Dazzle? Well, the main reason is that epoxies can sometimes endure micro scratches. They have excellent chemical resistance, but a urethane, like a two-component CRU, these are going to provide you with greater abrasion resistance and mar resistance. So when you get that higher traffic, putting the polyurethane top coat will help it'll take the burden off of the epoxy, if you will, and it'll provide you with a more resilient finish over that beautiful decorative finish. Now, additionally, we also have a water-based polyurethane. Now, we're going to go ahead and pass it over to Mike, and he's going to actually show you the mixing applications of our water-based polyurethane. Now, the water-based polyurethane is our SC65, okay? It's a two-component and a 3-to-1 ratio. So Mike is going ahead and he's using some of our nice liquid samples that we have available. So again, if you need to do a mock-up on site, you need a mock-up for maybe some sales tools, reach out to us directly and we can help you out with that. But Mike's gonna go ahead and mix this SC65 for 3 to 5 minutes, again, at a 3-to-1 ratio. Be aware that the SC65 is available in a pigmented, it's also available in a clear, and it's available in three gloss levels. We have a G for gloss, SG for a semi-gloss, and we have an F for a flat. In the pigmented version, we only carry that in the SG. Now, one thing to be aware, regardless of whether using solvent-based or water-based product, always mock up the finish for your customer. For example, after you apply the EC38, you're typically going to have a gloss finish. The epoxy on its own will typically provide a gloss sheen. So if you put SC65F on top, now you're going to kill the gloss. And some customers may love that look because it may be more natural and it may be a softer, lower sheen. Some customers may not like that and they may want the higher gloss. So you always want to be mindful of that, because it is something to keep in mind of what the overall sheen and gloss levels are in there. So again, you want to apply that material. There are some cases when you're applying this material, the SC65 is typically squeegeed, dipped and rolled, applied with a roller, that methodology. You can also spray and back roll, and you can also use an airless method to apply the water-based polyurethane. When applying a polyurethane on top of a smooth surface, such as the metallic epoxy liquid dazzle, be mindful that there may be a stippling, a light orange peel, or a slight texture that is produced because you're going over such a smooth surface and there's not a lot of surface tension there. So you may see some sliding. Be aware when you're applying to not overwork the material. Don't introduce too much air into the product. Maintain a wet edge. Effectively use the appropriate nap size roller cover. A lot of times applicators will have too large of a nap, you know, 1/4 inch, 3/8, typically all you need for that. If you start to get into these 1/2 inch and, you know, longer naps, you're just going to be putting down too much material, or you're potentially going to be creating air bubbles and excessive texture in the product when it's not needed. So always kind of approach it based on what surface you're applying. Again, we're going over a very smooth glass out epoxy. We do not need a coarse or long haired nap in this application. So 1/4 inch is typically standard application tool use. After you fully mix this product for again 3 to 5 minutes, you apply squeegee, back roll, dip and roll, airless. You can sometimes, depending on the methodology, use a pump sprayer, spray and back roll method. Again, all of these methods can be used. Typically, the SC65 water-based polyurethane does not require or does not need it to be reduced with water. If you're using the EC95 or EC95F, you typically do not need to reduce it, but you may need to reduce the 95F to achieve the proper coverage rate and yields so that it does turn flat. So again, with any product, please refer to the appropriate product specification sheet for more information on actual application, thinning, and coverage rates. So now we're going to see Mike go ahead and apply the SC65 directly over the EC38 in graphite. So he's applying a ribbon. You'll see him pre-wet his roller cover appropriately. And then you can see him applying the material nice and even, nice and tight. Now, About a year and a half ago, we made an upgrade to this product, changing it from a 2-to-1 to a 3-to-1. In doing so, we made it easier to apply, more forgiving, stabilizing the gloss, and producing a harder overall finish. So some of these attributes will really help when you're applying this product. You'll also notice ease of application, more stable gloss over the field. Again, whether it being a gloss, semi-gloss, or flat, a little bit more consistency across larger areas. Of course, if you introduce water as a thinning agent, be sure that you're applying thin enough so that the water can evaporate. When you're on a smooth surface like this, it's very important, and typically the requirements to applying this product with thinning is not necessarily needed, and you can just usually apply it neat, as you see here. So again, Mike's doing nice, even strokes, edge to edge, using a high quality roller cover, not overworking the material. At this point, you can see the material when it's applied, it kind of has a milky white haze. As that material dries and cures, that will all go away, and you'll be left with a nice, clean, clear finish. Again, regardless of what top coat you may use or elect to use, always do a mock-up to help indicate the finish, both in regards to sheen, texture, overall finish, just so your customer and you, the applicator, are on the same page, okay? So that concludes our liquid Dazzle system. Again, that is a 100% solids, metallic epoxy, that's very, very versatile for interior use only. So we're now gonna turn it over, and if there's any questions, we'll ask and do a little bit of Q&A. So there was a question regarding the yields or coverage rates on the SC65. That is gonna vary based on the surface. Typically on a Dazzle surface like this, you're approximately 400 square feet, give or take. Now, it depends on what you're looking for as far as mils, but the urethanes are thin to win. You do not wanna put these on thick like you would an epoxy. When you apply them thick, they typically will stay softer. You'll be a little more gummy, or you might not get the hardness. Additionally, you'll also get maybe potentially more roller marks. So always refer to the product specification sheets. For example, the SC65 product spec, which is both a pigmented spec, and there's also a clear spec. Please refer to those, and they'll indicate coverage both over smooth and or textured surfaces. So now what we're gonna do is we're gonna go ahead and do our, there's one more question that just came in. The question is, how well does the EC38 hold up to UV garage with windows? So it's a great question. Now it's all gonna be kind of dependent on what that garage is, what's the south-facing nature, if it's south-facing or not, the sun exposure, older windows versus newer windows. You know, most of your contemporary modern windows have adequate filtering to kind of help reduce the UV spectrum and UV lighting that's coming in. But do be mindful of that. Also during the installation itself, if you have, say it's a storefront and you've got windows all around the facility and you're doing an epoxy system, whether it be any of the systems that we've shown today, but specifically say the liquid Dazzle, you would wanna mask off all of those windows, okay? That can create difference in dry times. And sometimes what can happen if you don't mask off all those windows, you can actually see bubbling that will occur in your liquid Dazzle system or any of your epoxy systems. So taking rosin paper, Ramboard, Masonite, whatever materials you have available to block out that layer of heat and sunlight coming through will help to aid in a better application with an even finish. Now with the EC12 primer that we utilize in here, typically, as I mentioned, you're gonna use the complementary primer and you're gonna use one coat, but you may require two coats for best practice here. And that's to help ensure that the surface is sealed and completely primed prior to the application of the EC38. Again, what we're looking for is trying to stop any of the off-gassing or bubbling that can occur. So the question was, streak marks, do they go away with cure? Yes, application marks here, these will go away as this material starts to dry out. If you've overworked the material or you hit it too late, that's a common reason that some of these will freeze. Now, again, we're talking about a 4x4 board. Of course, if you're on a large scale project and you've got 10,000, 20,000 square feet, and you don't have, for example, joints or areas where you can start and stop, it does become much more challenging to maintain that wet edge. Anything you can do to kind of break up the space will help, methodically working and maintaining an even flow, having a finished roller, you know, cross hatching, and then coming back and having a finished roller that rolls edge to edge will help unify the finish of any of your urethanes, whether they be clear or pigmented. Also, if you have access to airless, or you can use a spray and back roll methodology, the spraying can sometimes help atomize, produce a nice even finish, and a light back roll to kind of tie that all together is a great way to go to try and, you know, basically do large scale projects with water-based polyurethanes. Now, if you are using the pigmented version of the SC65, we're not gonna recommend that being thinned because that will affect the opacity or hide of the product. So the question was, what coating has higher abrasion resistance, epoxies or polyurethanes? Always refer to, I'm gonna talk specifically just about abrasion resistance, but before I do that, be sure to refer to our chemical resistance chart, because there are going to be certain avenues or certain installations where you may require certain chemical resistance, and certain products will have greater chemical resistance than others, whether that be a polyaspartic, whether that be a Novolec over polyaspartic, whether that be a Novolec over a standard epoxy. But with regard specifically to abrasion resistance, generally speaking, your polyurethane materials, whether that be the water-based polyurethane or the solvent-based polyurethane, that's SC65 again, or EC95, those products are gonna offer you higher abrasion resistance. Now, polyaspartics are becoming very popular in our industry because of fast turnaround, versatility, but they still might not always provide the absolute highest abrasion resistance as, say, an aliphatic two-component urethane material like our EC95. When you need a product with the highest abrasion resistance in our line, you want to look at the EC95 material. That's going to provide you with the best abrasion resistance. Again, the water-based polyurethane will also provide you greater abrasion resistance as well. Be mindful if you have odor concerns, flammability concerns for that installation. Maybe you're working in a kitchen or a facility that has pilot lights or other potential sources of ignition. If that's the case and those cannot be turned off, you really want to consider utilizing the water-based epoxy or water-based polyurethane materials to provide you with a solution when there is the concerns of flammability. Okay, so that's our Q&As. I appreciate all the questions. Thank you so much for that participation. That really helps. And then I know other people of us are thinking those same questions as well. You know, I know virtually it's a little challenging. You know, we always like to have you guys in front of us, you know, either at your shop, at our distributor's warehouse, you know, to do these things in person. I do want to bring in Mike Pittman. Mike, you want to come over here? Get our 6 feet. This is Mike Pittman again. Thank you so much, Mike. Greatly appreciate all your support. And again, thank you all